But yeah, there was a time when I did not drink coffee, believe it or not, and that was when I first went plant-based, and I felt like I didn't need it, so.
Hey guys, just a quick reminder of the ridiculous deal that is the Vegan Health and Fitness Bundle. This is a vegan bundle consisting of 75 different vegan ebooks, all related to veganism, health, fitness, wellness, and self-improvement. This entire bundle is being sold for only $50 just for a few more days, and my Everyday Asian Recipes ebook is also included. So this bundle is valued at $1,600, guys, making this a 97% discount. So don't miss out, guys. Topics include vegan recipes, meal plans, grocery guides, meditation guides, yoga, wellness in general, fitness routines, workout guides, and so much more. Click the link down below to purchase and also get some more information. And now let's jump into the video.
Hi guys, it's Rose and welcome back to Cheap Lazy Vegan and another Vegan Talks video. For those of you that don't know, Vegan Talks videos are videos where I sit down and I talk about issues regarding veganism. So I have an entire playlist on this. So if you guys want to check out that playlist after you watch this video, link is down below. So today I wanted to do a good old-fashioned Q&A session and answer your questions specifically about going vegan, staying vegan, being vegan, veganism in general. So let's just jump right into it. I thought this would be a perfect time to do this sort of Q&A because it is January. A lot of people are going vegan for the month of January, and a lot of you might have different types of questions depending on where you are in your journey. So here we go, let's get started. So the first question is, how do you approach social situations with non-vegans? Do you bring your own food? Eat before you get there? I'm new to veganism and I always feel awkward and burdensome around my friends and family. So this is a very normal feeling, just putting this out there, to feel awkward and, you know, socially kind of isolated and weird in the beginning. So putting that out there, you're not the only one. So how do I approach social situations? It really just depends on the situation. First of all, now I've been vegan for a long time, and I will let you know that in the beginning is when usually it is the kind of worst when it comes to the social situations, especially around your friends and family, because they're not used to you being vegan. This is something new to them as well. So they don't really know what to do with you, okay? So after a while, it does get easier. So just putting that out there to make you feel a little bit better, it does get easier after a while because your friends and family, eventually they get used to it as well. It depends on the situation. So if I'm invited to a birthday party and I'm invited to a steakhouse for some strange reason, then I will most definitely eat something beforehand. So I can maybe get like a side, maybe like a salad or like a, you know, baked potato. Like, what do they have at steakhouses? Not much. Usually it's nothing as dramatic as a steakhouse. It's usually somewhere where you can get something vegan. So I would look up the menu item, okay? If you were going somewhere like a restaurant, for example, look up the menu beforehand if you can. If you want to be extra, you can call them beforehand. I pretty much almost never do that because I'm just lazy. So I look up the menu beforehand and see what I can do, see what I can get. You can always alter things, don't forget, okay? Maybe not always, but a lot of times you can alter things to kind of make it vegan. If you're meeting at someone's home, maybe you're having like a dinner at someone's home, I would communicate in advance. I would, you know, probably let them know, you know, you're following this vegan lifestyle. Tell them, like, you don't have to do anything if, you know, obviously it's something people are not used to as well. So just let them know, see what the response is. Tell them, maybe offer to bring something. That's what I always do as well. I offer to bring a dish so I can share it with everybody as well. Don't expect them to randomly have vegan options because, you know, maybe they just don't even know what veganism is. A lot of times people just have no idea. They'll make something and put like a bunch of cheese on it and then they're like, oh, that's not vegan? Oh. So don't expect them to know what it is, and always offer to make something and always offer to bring something for people. And when you offer to bring some food, when you offer to, you know, help out in that way, you can feel less like a burden because obviously you're doing, you know, a little bit of extra to help out the, you know, person that's hosting. And if they offer to make you something, then always, of course, you know, thank them and show appreciation and that you are willing to, you know, be open and be accommodating. So that's what I would do. Another little side note about like eating out and stuff, you know, eating beforehand. Once again, like I might do that if there are really no options for me, but I do try to not do that if there is an option that is like sufficient enough, because it's always awkward if you're like sitting at the table and you're not eating and everyone else is eating and you're just there like sipping your wine or drinking your water and then everyone else is eating, and it makes other people feel also a little bit awkward. So yeah, try to still order something even if it's something really small, and even if you ate something beforehand, if there is an option for you. Again, that's just my perspective. If you don't feel awkward, all power to you. Favorite vegan / meatless cookbooks besides your own, which is of course the best. Oh, thank you. Okay guys, so I have a confession. I am terrible with cookbooks. I have a few. Actually, I have a bunch. Whoo! Guys, here are my cookbooks. These are the physical cookbooks I have. I have a bunch of ebooks from other people as well. And of course, guys, if you want to check out my ebooks, link is down below. We've got like a whole bunch of stuff. Now for me, guys, I am terrible with cookbooks, mainly because it's not that I don't like cookbooks, but I think it's just that I don't like instructions, okay? That's one thing I've learned about myself over the years. I think I avoid following recipes if I can. Of course, if I want to make something specific, I have to follow recipes, but mainly I look at cookbooks just for inspiration, just to kind of like, you know, see what I can do, okay? And quite often I'll just kind of like do my own thing because I'm lazy. Like, I'm lazy to follow instructions. So I've got The Kitchen, awesome book. I love the, I think they're changing the name actually, but it's a lot of fun. It's very colorful, beautiful, and there's some basics in there. There's some like, you know, comfort foods, and yeah, it's good. I think I've made a couple things from here. I really should make more from these cookbooks. These are awesome. Anyways, I've got two from The Happy Pair. They actually gifted these to me when I was collabing with them in Ireland. You guys don't know Happy Pair, awesome duo. They are twins. They do fantastic, you know, vegan recipes, but again, delicious, very healthy, you know, wholesome meals, fantastic. I think this was one of the first ones I got, Skinny Bitch. To be honest, I don't know what I've tried from here. Again, I look at cookbooks mainly for inspiration, and I don't really follow a lot of recipes. It's bad, I know, I should. Recently I got this one from Caitlin Shoemaker, who's also a fellow vegan YouTuber, Instagrammer, all that stuff. Super exciting, look at this beautiful cookbook. And actually I was looking at some of these recipes and I did think, oh, I should, ooh, like look at this. Salted caramel chocolate chip cookies. I did think to myself, I really need to try some of these because they do look super awesome. Like her recipes also look really unique, a lot of them, which I really love. And then, oh, I don't know what this is. I think this is like a random Korean one my mom got me. So yeah, I'm terrible with cookbook reviews because I am terrible with following instructions. I'm definitely not the best one to give you any recommendations, but you know, those ones, they seem good, okay? How do you keep your food interesting? I get bored sometimes eating the same stuff, and that's when I start to miss foods I don't want to eat. Okay, so I mean, I think with me, it's a bit different because of what I do for a living. I make a lot of different recipes and I make a lot of different foods. Of course, there are certain dishes and meals that I gravitate toward and I make a lot of because I enjoy them. But I don't know, I don't get really bored very quickly because I do eat a lot of different things, I think, throughout my days. So even if I'm repeating them because I think they're delicious. So I don't know, for me, it's hard for me to answer that question because I can't relate, I don't know. I don't know if you guys have any suggestions on how to like not get bored. I mean, maybe if you are somebody that gets bored easily of food, you could try out different cookbooks and different recipes. I mean, I think it's exciting. I think especially in the very beginning when I was going vegan, I tried out a lot of different recipes because I wasn't used to the cooking vegan. So I did try out a lot of different recipes and it was always fun. And yeah, I think to switch it up, just, you know, try out different recipes from different people and yeah. And like also a reminder that there are so many different foods that you can eat as a vegan. I feel like the misconception is that, you know, you're so limited. But when it comes to, you know, animal products, like you're right. There's a lot of animal products and a lot of different things. But also there is an endless amount of plant foods. There are so many foods out there that you can try. There are so many dishes that you can try that you haven't tried. you know, I think changing your mindset is a big thing as well, and not thinking that, you know, this diet is restrictive, because it's just that you are eating, you know, a certain way and you haven't branched out. So that's one thing to take note. Another thing you could do is try out different dishes from different cultures. I think that's always really fun, trying out like vegan dishes from different cultures, or veganizing certain dishes from your culture or from different cultures. There are so many different cultures out there where it is actually pretty easy to veganize their dishes. And so I would try that out. I think that's a really fun way to experiment and see what else is out there. Another reminder that people that eat meat, people that are not vegan, a lot of them also kind of eat the same things all the time. Like, it's not that everyone has such a, you know, very varied diet if they're not vegan. It's not like that at all. I feel like, you know, when I see people eating, like, most of the time people are kind of like eating the same kind of things on a day-to-day basis. I'm sure we don't have as many like culinary options when we go out to eat when you're vegan, but I think for the most part, most people kind of repeat a lot of meals. So vegans are not the only ones that, you know, maybe eat similar things throughout their days. I think it's mostly everybody. Was there anything you first really struggled to give up and replace when moving to veganism? Yes, so my biggest thing, I've talked about this a million times, was fish. So for a long time, for years, I was actually a pescatarian. I had given up everything else, you guys. I had given up meat, dairy, eggs, everything else. I stopped buying leather. I started buying cruelty-free items. So I started doing a lot of other things. But the one thing that I really struggled with, I think it was also a very mental thing as well, was fish. So I loved sushi. I just like come from a background where, you know, there's a lot of, you know, fish ingredients in a lot of things. So giving up meat was like actually really easy. It was almost like, it was literally overnight. I just kind of gave up meat and it was fine. With fish, it took me a long time to process. I think it was also kind of that mental struggle of actually committing to this lifestyle. Fish was like the last thing that made me like not a vegan, right? If I were to give up fish, then I can like officially call myself a vegan. But then that would mean it was like a lot of kind of pressure almost to call myself vegan, because then I'm like, oh my God, now it's like, it's done. You know, like I'm vegan. It was like scary for some reason. Now it's like, again, you know, I can't imagine living my life any other way. But at that time it was like a scary thought, I think. But eventually I kind of like, I guess I faded it out. I phased it out. That's the word I'm looking for. I phased it out, and then eventually I stopped. So if there is something that you are struggling with, I think my first recommendation would be to cut out as much as you can, okay? Minimize your contribution to the exploitation of animals. So for example, like I didn't go to a zoo since I started being pescatarian, essentially. You can start buying cruelty-free, vegan, like beauty products. You can stop eating other foods that have animal products. And if there's one thing that you're like holding on to, you know, maybe you can hold on to it for a little bit, and then eventually you have to let it go. That's kind of like how I did it, I guess. Yeah. How do you motivate yourself to do a meal prep? I very much identify with the L in CLV. L being lazy, okay? Cheap, lazy, vegan. So I don't really meal prep much anymore just because of what I do for a living. I'm always making food and I'm always like surrounded by food. But when I used to not do this for a living, I used to meal prep a lot. My tip would be to not think about it so much. I feel like, you know, we think of meal prep and we think of like, you know, the perfectly lined Tupperware containers with like the rice and the tofu, and it's like beautiful, and you have to take an Instagram picture and it's all beautiful. But it's really doesn't have to be like that, okay? You can just literally make double, triple, quadruple the amount that you would normally make for one meal, and then just eat that throughout the week. Chili, I used to make chili all the time. Chili is so easy. Like any sort of like soup, chili, anything you can make in like one big pot and then just store in the fridge and the freezer. You can eat that throughout the week easily. Take the kind of fanciness out of meal prepping. Just make extra food. That's essentially what it is. Just make double, triple, quadruple, okay? That's all you need to do. Cost of groceries, how often do you buy food? Okay, well, I think that depends on what you do. What I do for a living now, you know, skews my perception a lot. I buy things as I go, as I need them. There are certain things I buy in bulk. So for example, like rice, I eat rice all the time. So buy a big bag of rice, and it's cheaper that way, and it's easier because you don't have to go shopping all the time. Other things you can buy in bulk, beans, like you can buy like dry beans that you can buy in like a big bag, and you can cook that from scratch, or you can buy a bunch of canned beans. I would suggest both. I actually have a vegan grocery guide that I filmed like a long time ago when I used to live in London, but I think it's still relevant today. It still shows so many different things that you could buy on a budget as a vegan. I think groceries in London when I lived in the UK were a lot cheaper than here in Canada, but it's still relevant, and I think the stuff I bought is still cheap in different places, just obviously relative to the expensiveness of that place and of the groceries of that place. But things like beans, legumes, rice, any types of grains, pasta, all those things you could buy in advance. Yeah, I'll link that video down below. I think that would be really helpful for you, the grocery guide that I filmed a few years ago. Is it normal for vegans to cheat from time to time, particularly on dairy? I'm a 95% vegan who struggles to be 100%. I mean, the word normal is subjective, I guess. Is it normal? No, not necessarily. The definition of vegan would be someone that abstains from it 100%. Now, is that realistic? Maybe not. I think that you have to try to do your best given what you have. It's a tough one because, again, maybe we're playing semantics by saying, like, you're not vegan if you're not, you know, abstaining from animal products and allowing yourself wiggle room. Then you would just be, you know, a vegetarian because you're eating dairy. It's hard to say. Like, it's hard to say. I would try not to. I think the more that you add it into your diet, like, even if you have it a small amount, you kind of keep going back to it, especially something like dairy, which is highly addictive. So, you know, you go back to it. I remember when I first was, like, vegan, maybe, you know, this is where you are at. I used to, like, play freeganism, not freeganism, yes, freeganism, where basically it's like, I'm not buying it. My friend just ate a piece of cake and there's like a little bit left over and she's not gonna finish it. And I'm not buying it. It's just gonna go to the garbage. I'll have a little piece of that piece of cake kind of thing. I used to do that. I'm not proud of it. I don't do it anymore, but I used to do that. And I call myself vegan. And I think, you know, in that circumstance, like, yeah, you're probably still vegan. Yeah, like it happens. That's what I'm saying. It does happen. So I guess like maybe it is normal. I've seen other people that were vegan, you know, that would, you know, maybe somebody, again, there'd be like a spread and then maybe they'll have like a little piece of something. Okay. So you're not the only one. Should we try to not do that? Probably. Yes. Should we normalize not doing that? Yes. Are you a bad person? I don't want to say that. No. But yeah, I do think that the problem though is allowing yourself that little bit of freedom kind of, I guess, makes your message wishy-washy. First of all, people see you and they think, oh, you're not actually vegan. Or, oh, is that what vegan means? Yeah, I don't have a firm stance on this, I realized. I think everyone's gonna have a different opinion on this. I know a lot of vegans will say, hell no, hell no, okay? I don't want to, you know, make that statement. I just want to say, do your best, do what you can. But I do think it's a good idea to try and abstain as much as possible from the animal products. Oh, there are a lot of questions, guys. Let me go to some of my Instagram questions. I know I had a few of those. Okay, so the next question, how do you deal with the struggle between getting completely vegan and just trying, which is still good? So I think that kind of like, I guess, branches off the last thing. I think it's great to continue to try, even if you're not vegan. I think it's fantastic to push people toward, again, guide people. Why do I keep saying push? Guide people toward the direction of plant-based living. I think that the reason why we use, you know, vegan and we talk about veganism and we want to have a little bit of a firm stance is because we don't want to have some sort of a wishy-washy message when it comes to something like animal cruelty and animal exploitation. So telling people that, oh yeah, it's fine if you eat, you know, cheese once a week, or if you, you know, eat this once a week, because then it doesn't send the proper message. Again, it's not as black and white as that, in my opinion. I think that it's so complicated because we live in such an unvegan world. So I do want to leave a little bit of, you know, not wiggle room, but I do want to let people know that, like, we are human and, you know, we are designed to be imperfect as well. But I do think it is important to also have, you know, kind of a very clear idea of what veganism is so that we are not diluting the message, whilst understanding that people are coming from different angles, different backgrounds, different cultures, and some people might find it more difficult than others to go vegan. How do you avoid deficiencies? Not only B12, but iron, calcium, omega-3. Whew! I've never had any issues with any deficiencies, actually, as far as I know. The only issue is that I've done blood tests once before going vegan, and then another one like 5.5 years later. I'll link that blood test down below. But based on my health, I haven't had any health issues. Again, I could have been maybe a little bit deficient at some point. I don't know. I haven't been practicing what I preach, which is getting regular blood tests, which I do recommend. But yeah, the last time I got a blood test, everything looked fine and normal. I didn't have an iron deficiency. I didn't have a B12 deficiency, but I do supplement with B12. I mean, I don't know about omega-3. Do people check that? I don't know. Anyway, my suggestion would be to supplement, maybe definitely take a B12, and I would take a multivitamin, and also eat a variety of different foods. You can be, again, deficient in anything at any point, whether or not you're vegan, so just be aware of that. It's not a vegan-only problem, it's a human problem that we might not have, you know, all of the requirements met all the time. So yeah, my suggestion would be to get blood tests done, maybe annually if you can, and also supplement things that are necessary, eat a variety of different foods, and yeah, that's my unqualified, unprofessional opinion. What do I do with all my non-vegan items I already bought? Slowly use them up and phase them out? That's a lot of food I don't want to waste or throw out. Oh, that's a good question. I guess it depends on your situation. If you can, give it to somebody else, if you can. If there are certain foods, maybe especially things that are like, I don't know, canned, or what non-vegan foods are canned? Like tuna or something, I don't know. If it's like canned things that you can give out to, you can donate, you can do that. I would phase it out. If you're new and you know you are just starting out, I would probably phase it out. I really don't believe in wasting food, so I really wouldn't tell you to throw it out because that's just a complete waste. You already bought it. So either eat it and phase yourself out or give it to somebody else. That's probably what I would do. Okay, so I got a ton of questions about family. So I've been vegan for 1.5 years, but how do you handle family? I also got any advice for criticism from family. This is the, again, very tough part. I think dealing with family and friends is one of the toughest parts about going vegan. So brace yourselves, it will happen. You will probably get some kind of criticism. Once again, just to put it out there, it most likely will get better after a little bit of time. It's just that people, again, are just not used to it. Even maybe after 1.5 years, they're still not really used to you being vegan. I guess it depends on how often you see them as well. I think it's important to communicate firmly but nicely that you are doing it for your reason. Specifically, it's nothing to do with them. Maybe you have to reiterate that you're not trying to change them. It's just this is your personal, you know, lifestyle and your decision. And I think, you know, being very strong on your why is very important. If you're wishy-washy, people are gonna notice. People are gonna see it. They're gonna see, oh, she's not that serious. I'm gonna make fun of her. I'm gonna try to poke at her. But if you're serious about it and it's showing, then people are less likely to, you know, continue to make fun of you or tease you or bother you about it. Yeah, confidence is everything. You know, if you are confident in your why, then that's the first step. It's hard for me because my family has been always relatively supportive about this. So I think if they're concerned about your health, maybe send them some resources along the way to kind of show them that, you know, there really isn't anything to worry about. I think one way to really prove them that you're doing fine is to just live your best and healthiest life, you know? Don't be deficient. Don't, you know, follow some crazy raw vegan diet. And show them that you're healthy and you're good and you're thriving. And that itself is, you know, the proof is in the pudding, okay? The proof is in the pudding. So show them that you're not missing out. Yeah, just communication. That's a huge thing. Can you do a video on your favorite vegan substitutes? For example, your favorite milk, yogurt, cheese, deli meat, cream cheese, nugget, butter. Woo, that's a lot. Yeah, I could probably do that. Although I don't use that many, I guess, alternatives, like substitutes. But actually, I can think of a few things that I do buy relatively regularly. So yeah, that's a good idea for a video. Let me write this down. Oh. What to eat for lunch when you don't want to cook, but you don't like avocado or hummus? Do you like chickpeas? I like to make chickpea salad. So like mashed chickpeas and then add some like vegan mayo if you have it, some like Dijon mustard, some garlic powder, relish, and then just like put that in a sandwich. And there you go, we got a chickpea mash sandwich. Yeah, and we have like, there's so many things you can make. No cook lunches. That's also a good idea for a video. Have you noticed any improvement in your health? I talked about this before. It's hard to say because I didn't go vegan for health reasons. I never had any issues with health when I went vegan or mostly plant-based. And it's also hard to say because, like I said, I was pescatarian for years and then I went vegan. So by the time I went vegan, I was already eating a predominantly plant-based diet. But I do remember when I first went mostly plant-based and I was pescatarian and I first gave up meat, dairy, and eggs, the first thing I noticed, and this was like very significant, was a huge increase in energy. I remember I was in university at the time and I used to drink a giant coffee from Tim Hortons like every single day. I used to drink that every morning and I went to university and that's what I would drink and that's how it would function. I would have a hard time getting up in the morning, you know, as a lot of people do. But I remember when I first started eating mostly plant-based, my energy level was like crazy. Like I would get up in the morning and I would be fine. Like I would be like energetic in the morning. When I had just gotten up, which usually doesn't happen, I felt very rested. I felt like I slept really well and I felt like I didn't need coffee. So in that initial stage, I actually stopped drinking coffee for like a long time. I was like, oh, I don't need to drink coffee anymore because I don't need it. Because I used to drink it to like, you know, wake up. Yeah, so I stopped drinking coffee for like, I think like 2 years or something. I drank it sometimes, just, you know, out of leisure or social situations. But yeah, there was a time when I did not drink coffee, believe it or not. And that was when I first went plant-based and I felt like I didn't need it, so. Do you think it's better to transition gradually or overnight / over a few days? I did it slowly as I found out about each industry separately, but I wish I educated myself and went vegan instantly. Personally, this is my personal opinion based on my experience. I think it's better to transition slowly. That's my perspective. I think there's a few different reasons for that. Number one, a lot of people, when they go vegan overnight, it's kind of an impulse decision. It's not something they've thought through and it's something that they don't know much about. They don't know how to eat. There's no preparation. So they go vegan overnight and a lot of times, unfortunately, they might lose this like bout of inspiration. Because what happens is a lot of times people might watch a documentary, read a book, or hear about something and then they go all in right away. And it does work for some people. So I'm not completely dismissing it as a potential, you know, option for you. Yeah, so I think I would do it gradually. Maybe I probably, you know, in hindsight, I would have gone vegan sooner than later, but I don't regret doing it relatively gradually as I found out more information and as I found out how to eat as a vegan. So it takes time sometimes, you know, it takes time to slowly get used to it. Your body needs to get used to it. Your mindset has to get used to it. You know, you dealing with social situations, that's also a difficult thing a lot of people don't realize until they go vegan. So for me, my personal opinion is transitioning slowly. That's my personal opinion. People are gonna have a different opinion on this, but that's my opinion. How to not feel crazy if you are the only one around in your social circles that is vegan. After 2 years of veganism, no one ever touched the subject, even though I'm never militant. Are they afraid of a genuine talk, afraid of confrontation with rational, fact-based arguments, afraid that I judge them? Yes, all the above, probably. The thing is, if you're vegan, like, if you know, you know, right? Okay, if you know, you know. This is like one of those things where I feel like I'm in a room with everybody, okay? We're all in this room and we are all, you know, looking at the same things. And all of a sudden, I get a key to this other room and I walk into this other room and I see all of the things that are happening in this other room, okay? And it's not pretty. It ain't pretty. I don't wanna be there. It's not pretty. So I tell everybody, guys, like, come into this other room. You wanna see what's going on over there? Nobody wants to come in, okay? Maybe that's not the best analogy. But basically, like, you know, right? If you're vegan, you know. So don't feel like you're the crazy one, okay? The more I live on this earth, the more I realize so many of the things that we do, just because it's the norm does not mean that it's a good thing. Actually, quite often, it's the opposite. The norm is not always a good thing. I hope that you realize that you are not the crazy one. And the reason why a lot of people don't want to talk about it is because, yeah, exactly that. They don't want to hear it because they don't want to change what they're doing. And they don't want to feel guilty about what they're doing. So the more that they avoid the topic, the more likely they can just continue to feel fine about what they're doing. If they see what's going on, then, you know, they'll feel more guilty, right? Just because everyone else is doing one thing does not mean that that's how everyone should be living. And I've said this before, but when you look at, you know, movements around the world, things that have happened throughout history, civil rights movement, women's rights, you know, even gay rights, all of these things in the beginning had a lot of opposition and had a lot of backlash, and a lot of people thought you were crazy if you were the one trying to change the status quo. So that's the same with vegans, but it's worse for vegans because vegans are not fighting for themselves, they're fighting for animals that cannot speak for themselves. So it makes it harder, okay? Whereas every other, you know, movement, people fought for their own rights, whereas like we're fighting for the rights of non-human animals, which makes it extra hard. So doesn't mean they're bad people necessarily, it's just that, you know, they would rather not be confronted with their own hypocrisies, okay? Guys, I hope you enjoyed this Q&A. Sorry I couldn't get to all the questions. There were quite a few, and I do apologize if you submitted a question and I didn't answer it. Maybe I'll do another one if you enjoyed this one and answer the rest of the questions there. But yeah, I hope you guys found this video helpful in some way. And I'll link my Vegan Talks playlist down below, as well as I think the grocery haul and maybe some other videos that I think you might find helpful if you are new to this lifestyle. And hope I offered you some words of encouragement. Maybe? Possibly? Anyway, guys, if you enjoyed this video, please give it a big thumbs up. And if you're new to this channel, of course, don't forget to subscribe. And I'll see you guys in my next video.